Let's see here. Welcome back, ladies and germs, to the latest installment of the Champions of Nern campaign, starring our heroes, the Crimson Bones. What's here for the Crimson Bones? Come on, everyone.
Crimson Bones.
The Crimson Bones.
Where last we left our heroes, Manadian and Ulzgul arrived back from their nightly expedition, stalking around the Highborn district in search of their next target at the behest of their client, Gwarthir. Packing it up early, deciding it a fruitful effort, resting and training into the morning, respectively. And at Red Face Jack's, a new dawn came. In the morning, the Crimson Bones retreated to breakfast by Red Face Jack, and Mandian picked your host's brain in regards to their client and the sewers beneath the city. They met another patron of Red Face Jack's, who was apparently renting one of the other rooms there, a young mage by the name of Caden. After enjoying the morning at Red Face Jack's, the Crimson Bones went off to the jail ward under invitation from the sergeant at arms, Sir Barrows. There you met him and had a brief discussion about your client Gwarthir and the sewer system, as well as the magical amulets that are issued out by the city guard to allow the Magic Queen Quind to cast spells in the vicinity of the anti-magic shell known as the Dram Ward, lest we forget, of course. Bidding Sergeant Barrows farewell, the Crimson Bones decided what to do next, which was seemingly to investigate the mysterious sewers everyone keeps hearing so much about. After ripping up a sewer grate from a cobblestone yard in the ground, underneath the noontime sun, after Manny Gelden has just finished telling Syphax that danger was cool, he has plunged 25 feet down into the depths of an odoriferous, damp sewer works beneath the city, leaving his comrades behind. There.
I'll say that's pretty cool.
There, in the depths, the sounds of horror drift about as a metal clanging. And now, Mandy and Gelden, now that you find yourself down in this space, you hit cold, cold stone, and it was a wow, thwack. You've already suffered your 8 bludgeoning damage. Reduced naturally from at the end of last episode, and you find yourself here, my friend, on your back on the earth, looking straight upward, a small square chute, probably about 5 feet or so wide, 25 feet up above you, with no discernible way to get yourself back up. What do you desire to do? It is damp down here.
I want to stand up, at least, if I physically can.
At the very least, you get to your feet. Around you immediately on top of this cold, pretty finely laid brickwork, is the remnants of the wooden ladder, which is pretty much splintered to pieces underneath the sheer weight of your person. And you rise to your feet quite ably, but it is dark down here. The light that is being shown from the entrance in which you arrived and in which Syphax is peering down to you from now is only shining so much light in your area, and you feel like you're in quite a considerable space, it feels, down here. You'll have to get a light source of some caliber going in order to see more.
Can I find my pebble that's glowing that I dropped down here?
I would say so. It's probably just, a handful of feet away.
Nice.
Just on the ground.
I think that gives me, 10 feet? 5 feet?
I think oh. five. I think five, maybe 10. I'm not sure. I couldn't exactly say.
5 foot radius, bright and a 5 foot dim and another 5 foot. So oh, 10 Jesus. Feet total.
Oh, interesting. All right.
Yeah.
All right. So be it.
And what? There's something coming from my left or something? Is it clanging?
Down in this area, this metal banging that you heard has seemingly subsided for now.
Okay.
But to your left, you hear now where you think the metal rattling was coming from, the heavy footfalls of a large something. Seems to you possibly like a humanoid. Give me a perception check, Mandy, perception please, check. Dear God. You still can only see so much in this area. You've yet to be able to make visual contact of any of the walls in this space. You can see but cold stone floor for, you know, as round you as far as the eye can see. The beginnings of some type of, you know, like metallic material starting to begin in the floor, up to your north, about 10 feet or so away. But to your left, what would be from the current direction you are facing, the that's Jesus Christ. From the east, aka your left currently with the direction you're facing, you hear the heavy footfalls of something, and then the just the chuckling of some type of perhaps man. Seems like he's making his way on over.
I would like to draw my palm pistol and my glass beetle at the same time, and I would like to radio to Uzgold that I could use a little help down here before pointing my gun in the general direction of that sound.
Okay. All right. Uzgold Bonebreaker, you get relay.
Oh, is that Manny? Let me talk to him, Uzgold. I want to talk to him. I need to make sure the gold's okay.
Get back, Skeezball.
as you're fending Skeezball off, Uzgold, Skeezball, and Syphax, you three find yourselves up at the top of where Manion and your friend Manion Gildan has entered.
I'm at the mouth of the hole.
And probably only about like 5 feet or so away. You aren't peering into it. Syphax is like, you know, leaning over the hole. Shouting after Mandy and Geldon.
Oh boy. And what's the message that I received?
I could use a little help down here.
Okay. It doesn't sound too distressed.
And almost as if on cue, Uzgold Bonebreaker, Syphax, and Skeezle Bimbag. You guys are in this, you know, this kind of like courtyard area. Let's see. I don't have quite a visual, but I will take us to the city map so we can get a refresher as to our about positioning. You guys are just away from Red Face Jax, pretty much just a good. Let's see. A nice 80 feet away from one of the main roadways in this little, you know, courtyard-esque area. There's a few, you know, crates and supplies, you know, very similar to the area where you were, like, ambushed by Kenkus. You know, there's like a kind of like a little like supply storage, you know, like private, just, you know, miscellaneous yard area. And almost as if on cue, Uzgold, when receiving this message, from one of the three-story windows of one of these ramshackle buildings, the shutters swing open. What the hell is all that damn noise down there? You down there? What's all that racket?
Just routine maintenance. It'll be over soon enough.
Deception check sees open back. Stepping in. Well, come on, keep it down. Jeez, you guys don't look like you're from the guard to me.
Contractors, and we'll be as quiet as mice.
You better be, or all of the Crimson Bones come over here and show you what's what.
Lizgood pays no mind to this going on. Syphax, you got a rope?
Let's see. And Syphax goes about his person, trying to attempt to find one. And then you hear, you guys hear us from over yonder on the other side of this little yard area, another window, you know, of a domicile opens, as Syphax is searching in his backpack. And you can hear, oh, what's that? The Crimson Bones? The Crimson Bones are here?
And Syphax, Syphax. 25 feet of rope for Ulzgood.
Okay. All right. Very good. Before Syphax can present anything, Skeezwell Binbag has presented rope, and that's good because doesn't seem like Syphax has much of any.
Okay. I will take the rope and I will tell Skeezwell to deal with these people. And me and Syphax will set up a rope to go down.
Okay. Very good. Ooh.
Yeah, it's just routine sewer work. No Crimson Bones out here. Back to your business.
Damn. All right. Give me more. Give me some more deception checks. These have been bad because now these two are kind of like talking between each other from these windows. They're like, oh, they say they're working on something down there, but all I heard was a huge bang. I don't know. This guy's like, I don't know. This guy seems pretty convincing. I'm not so sure.
Skeezle leans into it. Come on, hurry up. Get that rope down. We gotta get out of here.
Okay. But pretty good, Skeezle Binbag. You'll probably be able to stave off the crowd for a few minutes here. By just talking, you're keeping it all in the down low, and it seems like they're beginning to lose interest. So hopefully you can just keep it going with the deflections. Ulzgood, Bonebreaker, and Syphax. Ooh, I mean, it's probably like a 20. It could be probably about 25 feet down to the floor of where Mandy and Gelden is, which is, won't be so bad. Potentially, he was hoping. Yeah, there isn't much to fasten the rope to. You could fasten to the grate, which is nearby, which may prove as some type of suitable anchorage if you desire to go for that.
Can I kind of like prop the grate back where it's supposed to go, kind of, and like tie the rope on that too?
Sure. I don't see why not. Partially, yeah. That'll be good. All right. Well, I'll leave it up to you. It seems it was a Bonebreaker with advantage. You may perform a strength check with advantage, naturally. Especially since Syphax is lending a hand. So yeah, there you go. It was good. No. Yeah, like that. There you go, huh? Excellent. And with that, you seem like, you have a dank rope fastened, which is fortunate. Because meanwhile, Mandy and Gelden, you hear, some voices up there. Eventually, Syphax stops yelling in your direction. It seems like something's distracted him from up top. And the laughing gets ever, creepier and closer. and around your neck, Mandy and Gelden, the amulet that Lokir Bitterroot gifted you to alert you of the nearby foul energies of Dram the Dark begins to activate with a purplish hue.
Not the Dramulet.
Unfortunately so. The footfall is growing ever closer. Bandy and Gelden, is there anything you're up to down here while the Crimson Bones are stalling the crowds and preparing?
Mandian, with a firm voice, yells, "Get back!" and launches a fireball in the direction of this voice.
Oh, okay. Very good. Very good. Unleash your fireball if you dare. Oh. Mon frere.
I will.
With furiosity and precision, the likes of which Manny Gildon is a natural at dishing out, you cast your baseball-sized firebolt from the palm of your hand eastward, and you see it illuminating. Ooh, let's see. I'll give you exacts. Ooh, this is pretty good. A pretty accurate casting. Dun, 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 dun. Ooh, it goes about a good 20 feet or so eastward, and then it finally begins to illuminate the very similar material floor, walls, a heavy brickwork that seems to go up pretty much as high as the firebolt, quickly illuminates. It's only a 4-second affair at most. And you see it strikes. You've struck a door of some type, a metallic, vertically iron barred type door. It seems to you. Your firebolt makes impact with it. And without seeing anything on the other side of the bars, the firebolt light dissipates.
Okay. Would I get the sense that this is like a 20-foot cubed room or something like that?
Something like that. You probably would get that sense.
Okay.
You're an adventurer.
I would like to do a quick circle around the room. Around the perimeter to make sure there's no other doors before stopping by the door I just struck.
Okay. Is there a cardinal direction you desire to go for first?
I want to go counterclockwise.
Oh, shit. Okay. Okay. Is there any particular, starting direction, I guess, that you want to go?
Starting towards the door and then doing a circle around.
Okay. Very good. You close about 15 feet in the direction of the door. Let's see. Let me give you what you should have. You're still just going to use your pebble for light?
Yep.
Okay. Very good. Just making sure.
That is the truth.
So you make out until you can just make out the iron bars in your periphery. It seems like there's a little metal wall lantern scone-esque furnishing that has long since deteriorated and been fallen to the side, shattered, because it is dark down here. You kind of follow the walls for a little bit, probably only about a few seconds. You kind of get to the one corner of the room, what would be the northeastern corner, and don't find much. It seems there's no furnishings, there's no even like inlets or anything to that regard, and you start now in the top right corner moving westward, and about in the middle of the room you hit a grate that's pretty close to the northern wall. You kind of like shine your light down through it as you pass by it. You cannot see what is down there. It seems like it just continues deeper and deeper down into who knows where. Continuing to scan along the perimeter walls, you get you're hugging now the westernmost wall of this, what you now assume to be a rectangular room. Seems to you it's about 45 feet or so wide and at least 30 feet long. You haven't seen the southern portion yet, but this is when you see a rope that flops down to your side, Mandy and Gelden, from just about where the this ladder debris dangles and where the spotlight of daylight is pouring in. A rope is now present.
Very nice. Okay. Could I use all three charges of my defensive field?
Sure. Sure. Yeah, if you desire to. If you desire to.
Excellent. So that's a straight D10 now. Roll. Okay.
Yes. Yeah, yep. Yep. D10.
Yeah.
Pretty good.
All right. That's what, 24? Very good.
Could be way worse. You spent about 30 seconds doing that. During that time, Uzgold, Syphax, surface team, what are you guys up to? Skeezel Bimbeck seems like he's doing well, stemming the tide. You've deployed the rope. I mean, what's the play?
Do we see that fireball going off down there?
Ooh, I mean, you know what? Probably you and Syphax would, because your guys' attention has been more focused on the Syphax affair. So
I'm getting in there.
Or, you know, the Mandian affair. Okay, you're descending first.
Oh yeah.
All right. Okay. Syphax, like, all right. Good luck down there, buddy. And Uzgud Bonebreaker begins descending. Why don't you give me a dexterity check, Uzgud Bonebreaker, to swell your way down the rope. Oh, shit. No way. No way, Jose.
Jesus.
All right. And you start making your way. And this old rope breaks about halfway.
Love it.
And you find yourself all of a sudden, Uzgud Bonebreaker, making your way downtown fast. Give me an acrobatics check, Uzgud Bonebreaker. Because you are at least a dexterous sort. Oh, man. Ooh, you take 6 bludgeoning damage, reduced in half, thanks to you rolling and tumbling as you fall. But nice. Now Uzgud Bonebreaker has joined the fray.
The hell is going on down here, Mandian?
Stand your guard. My amulet's purple. And Gildan keeps his eyesight on the doorway.
What can I see?
You drop in, Uzgud Bonebreaker, and can see the entirety of this area. Mandy and Gildan would be to like your left on the western side, pretty close touching the wall, and to your right, opposite end of the room, past vertical iron bars, you see in what's probably a 10 by 10 foot squared hallway, past these vertical iron bars is a large, mostly naked man, it seems to you, who is taking up almost the entirety of the space, and it's like hunched over in the interior, with his yellow eyes looking back over in your direction. And you see his big mouth. And it's got a pretty gnarly looking big mouth.
All shit.
And the figure laughs.
Wolfsgood calls out, "Who are you?"
"I'm Geth."
And he takes another step forward with a bone breaker, and he like grabs onto the iron bars that separate you and he. And he brings his face up pretty close to the large iron. It looks like it could even be steel, possibly. This door here, very intense, has, you know, instead of it being many bars, it is three thick, like, you know, steel bars, that are, you know, pretty gnarly.
Geth, you say?
Yes. What are you doing down here?
I was about to ask you the same. We're just exploring.
Maybe you shouldn't explore down here. The burnt man haunts the tunnels.
And he rattles the steel door, and the whole thing like shakes with his person.
I'm gonna try something here. You said this dude's taking up the whole fucking hallway, right?
He's big. He's let's see. The hallway's probably a good, like, 8 feet or so tall, and probably a good 10 feet or so wide. And this big steel door is probably about 6 feet tall, and he's like lurching down underneath, and you know, he has to hunch over, you know, to grab this, and he's mostly naked as far as what you can tell. You don't see any armor or any type of, you know, significant clothing on this individual at all. Doesn't look very clean. Looks like perhaps he's been down here for a little while.
Why don't you give me a...
Yeah, ooh. Nice.
What do you need, sir?
Ooh. What about a nature check, was good bone breaker from you in this moment, while we switch back to our surface team and see what they're getting onto during the sequence?
I'm gonna try something
Okay. All right. I'll give you another minute or so to prepare that. Skeez whooping bag. What are you up to, baby? Your comrades have descended. Underground, and Syphax is sitting up there, kind of looking over the hole. Like, all right, Skeez. Well, Wuzgood's down there, and Mandian. I guess. I don't know what happened. I think Wuzgood kind of fell. What do you want to do? You and Syphax.
I hate to say it, Syphax. We have to go down.
Oh, man. Do you have anything that can get us down there?
What is the rope gone?
The rope has been entirely used in the descending process by Uzgud Bonebreaker.
Descending process.
So you hope that you didn't sit there and watch. You've been dealing with these pedestrians that are, you know, still kind of looming and still kind of checking you out, despite your excellent deflections. There's, you know, even though they're not gawking quite as loudly as before, you know, they're still watching you. It doesn't seem like they maybe have anything better to do, perhaps, than to curiously, passively watch you now. So, as far as you know, the entire rope has been used, and Wuzgud Bonebreaker's descended, but fell for some reason. Syphax hasn't elaborated. What are you thinking, Skeez Whooping Bag? What's the play?
Alright, Syphax, look busy. I'm gonna check the hole.
Nope, okay. Alright. And since Syphax attempts to look, to look busy and official to some regard. And you peer down, Skeezle Bimbag, and you see Uzku Bonebreaker and hear faint voices reverberating and echoing, getting all confused in this that underground environment. It seems like Uzku Bonebreaker is speaking to someone potentially down there. And you see a rope that descends.
All right, Syphax, get in the hole. We're going down.
Well, what, me first?
Skeezwell climbs onto the rope.
You big baby, and starts descending.
Okay, all right. Syphax watches intently. All right, I'll be right behind you. And excuse me, Bimbag, why don't you give me a dexterity check as you start your way down the rope, or slower, it doesn't matter. Either way, it doesn't matter how safe you want to take it. But you take it fairly safe, going inching your way down, and you find eventually Skeezle Bimbag. Well, we'll get there in a moment. It was good, Bonebreaker. What are you up to? You hear the shuffling of Skeezle Bimbag as he's like, coming, scraping himself over the edge and coming down this chute.
How is that that nature check?
The nature check wasn't what I was hoping for, personally.
Wasn't what I was either. I'm still gonna try something though. I'm gonna call out in giant. I'm gonna say, it's a burned man, brother.
And there's this moment of hesitation. You see the yellow eyes kind of, widen for a moment, and there's this look of fear as the large man starts backing away and retreats from whence he came, as Skeezle Bimbag descends his way. Down the rope.
Here. Maniangel tries to shake the door. Pull it open.
Okay. You head over and start you can hardly even get your, hand around, these huge steel iron bars. They're pretty gnarly, pretty impassable. And as you attempt, just trying to grab the side of it, you look down and notice that the white around your neck has not faded.
Oh.
Cecil Bimbag, you're descending down the rope quite masterfully and then find it ending, and your feet reaching for nothing underneath you. You find yourself dangling suddenly. What's the play?
Skeezle looks down.
Excellent. Very good.
Tries to determine if it is safe or not to drop.
Okay. Give me an intelligence check. Ooh. It looks like it's probably only about a 10-foot drop or so. If you land and allow your body to spring, you should be okay.
Is there water down there?
No. It seems quite dry. Oh, okay. It seems quite dry.
Skeezle is going to drop down.
It's like hard stone. I was trying to clarify.
Yeah.
Damp hard stone. Okay. All right. Very good. You drop. Doing a bit of a tumble as you fall. And that is when you gentlemen hear from somewhere in the room, somewhere in the darkness. Uzku Bonebreaker, you look around. Attempting to spot whatever source is making this noise. Give me a perception check. or ride the passive. It's your call.
I'll hit my 15.
Okay. Okay. You look about. Oh, you know what? You know what? I'll have the creature. You know. You know what?
What?
I've got some.
Oh, baby.
What?
Yeah. Ooh. You look up, Uzku Bonebreaker, and from the ceiling, from like a crack, where the wall meets the ceiling, is slithering out this almost like insect-like, oval-eyed little like imp-like beast that slithers forth and pops down upon the ground. And that is where I'll bring the boys immediately before anything changes. Before we get too carried away. We have... our heroes.
Hero.
That's
down,
us.
Down in the depths of the Garza sewer network. And it seems like from each corner of the room is slithering up these terrible little beasts. And they start making their way towards you. At this point, boys, you can select your tokens respectively and roll for initiative.
Done.
It's in the northern and southern sides of the room. You spot creature features.
Creature features. Oh, I never finished my module, did I?
No, I'm sorry.
I wasn't even close. I was 4% done.
Oof, yeah, it's rough. Yeah, it was rough. Not the best. Not the best. I wasn't, you know. I was rooting for you with that one, too. I think you only worked on it for, you know, like 3 hours, though, so.
Yeah, I got a little distracted.
It happens. Ooh, exciting, lads. Let's see. Let's turn the music around. Let's turn the music around town. Oh. All right. Oh. Big hype. Manny and Gelden, how about a history check from you?
Yes, sir.
You're just the analytical type.
Yeah.
He's a smart boy.
Manny and Gelden, these creatures at first glance as you, well, I don't even know if you can make them out. No, you can't even see them.
I can see 10 feet from me.
Oh, you know what? Hold on. You can see 10 feet in front of you. That is, you can. It is true. you should be able to see the boys, but technically they're not casting light. And that little daylight doesn't count as a light source, but I will alleviate that. Briefly. Let's see. Ooh, it's probably gonna look a little bit like that. Maybe something like that.
Ooh.
There we go. Okay, so that torch will symbolize, you know, the daylight pouring in from the entrance in which you gentlemen just arrived.
Right.
But other than that, yeah, no, you gentlemen can't make out shit. But you know what? Skeezel Binbag, what can you see? Oh, too much.
Too much.
Let's see. You should probably be like something like that. There you go. Sorry, Skeezel Binbag. That's all you get to see too. It is very, 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 very dark down here. Who's good Bonebreaker? You are the only one that can make out.
You see everything.
But Manny Gelden, when the time comes, that history check will come into play. God willing, I won't let it go to waste. Oh man. Okay. Let's see. Alright, it's initiative time for the creatures. Whoopsie. Whoopsie.
Whoops.
Let's get Bonebreaker. How about a history check from you? Since you're the one that can see everything. That's what I should have done to begin with. Oh well.
Yeah. Damn. Two bad ones.
You're right. Shit! Shit, I could have. You don't know. You don't know.
Like, what the fuck are these?
Yeah, you could. Yeah, you're not sure. You're not sure. You can't quite place them. You can't quite place them. It's the. Damn. Okay. I'll get everything organized up. I think, Usku Bonebreaker, you're going to be up first at the end of the organization, so do prepare yourself.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord above. Okay. All right. Usku Bonebreaker, we start with you. Like these little creatures have appeared. They look at these little disgusting, almost like alien-like bipedal creatures that only stand probably about 2 feet tall off of the ground. Very disgusting. Very disturbing.
Ugh.
Pointed ears, these little antenna-like horns. These little tails. Disgusting. And there's quite a few.
Uzgood looks around the room and yells out to the Crimson Bones. They think they can surround us. I enter a rage, drawing my sword.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, very good. Very good. Your rage enabled. Your short sword drawn.
My silver longsword.
Silver longsword drawn. Good to know. Very good. Very good. Anything else, Master Bonebreaker?
I tell Mandian and Skeezel to take the north, and I will head down to these ones down here.
Roger that, it was cool.
Sick. All right. Very good.
I'll head down here and attack this one.
Very good. As such, Master Bonebreaker, let loose. Tweep! That first one hits.
These ones today.
They're out here. A nice chop into like the top left-hand shoulder of the beast. It cleaves in a decent amount, and then the creature like swells out of it and kind of like jumps up onto the sword, batting it aside. You have been disarmed of your silver longsword, Usku Bonebreaker, from your critical fumble. I'm sorry.
How dare it.
It is just on the ground next to you. You watch, Usku Bonebreaker, as it falls into the grate, like blade first, and it almost goes all the way, and then the guard on the hilt like stops it from falling in entirely. A close call. Okay. You'll be able to retrieve it likely at the next round, as you find yourself a bit naked at this moment.
And now, sorry.
Now we've got some. Oh, some of these little naughty little beasts that are come rolling up, and they are gonna come take a little chunk out of sweet Usgood Bonebreaker. Let's see. Thanks to their pack tactics ability, these dramlings will have advantage on this strike.
No,
it's gonna give you a little bite. Oh shit. For five piercing damage. reduced. Thanks to your rage, thank God. And that's it for that one. You are just bitten on. You are bitten in the back of the thigh. It was a bone breaker by one of these little creatures. That to take the opportunity. Simultaneously, Skeezel Binbag, from out of the darkness, you are quite rudely set upon by one of these little alien creatures as well that will attempt to take a strike at you. It attempts to bite you at the knee. Does a 13 strike you?
I believe that's my class. Let me just take a look.
Do a double check.
Fourteen.
Oh, damn. Okay, very close. Narrowly. Skeezel Binbag, you have your left knee chomped, but you withdraw your left leg just in the nick of time. And it is up to you, my friend, Master Binbag. What will you do? This small, 2 foot tall, alien, pygmy imp type beast threatens your lower area.
Okay, so what happens if I try to cast a spell again? Like, I have to make a
you have to make a check. Yeah, you have to make a check based around your spell casting modifier, which would be charisma. You need at least a 15, or else your spell will not work. You can cast cantrips at free will.
Right.
But any first level or higher.
The spell slot as well.
Whether it works or not, it will use the spell slot to symbolize,
that's the risk I'm willing to take.
Yes, yep. And that symbolizes like the mental fatigue that the Dram Ward has on spell users. Okay. Well, with that,
I'm doing it. Skeezel is going to cast Wall of Fire. He's going to attempt to cast Wall of Fire.
Sick. Sick. Okay, hit me up with the deets. Oh, you can make a charisma check, Master Binbag. You can just click on your charisma attribute. and God willing, it's good.
Yeah, baby.
It works. You are able to cast Wall of Fire. Mandy Gelden, you watch. You watch as Cecil Bimba, you may describe how is the unveiling. Yeah,
there is indeed in describing to do as well. So
yes, it's up to you.
Is going to.
Oh, and you can hit me with the spell description as well, please. And I'll read over that as you're embellishing your sick spell display in front of Manny and Gelden and Syphax, who watches from above. Sick. Very cool.
Okay, so I am going to make a ringed wall. 20 feet in diameter.
Okay. Alright. Let's see, I'll bust out. It's gonna look a little shitty, but we can bust out something like this. Yeah. Now it's a little bit too thick. We'll just use a marker. Let's see.
Oh, you're a little too thick.
It's gonna be something kind of like that, maybe? That'd be too small.
Yeah, that's 10 foot right, actually.
It's 10 foot radius, so is that 20 foot diameter?
Yeah.
Correct.
Okay. Yes. All right. Okay. That's what I thought. Okay. What can I say?
We be
all right. What do you think? How thick is it?
It's 1 foot thick.
Okay. So that's kind of about right then, I guess. Maybe I could be like that, kind of. Okay. All right.
Yes. So like between me and that creature.
Do you want it like as such here, or would you want it some other way? Can you see that? Oh yeah. I mean, you kind of see it. The ring like, kind of starts at you right now and like goes around surrounding the creature. Do you want the ring around you in between the creature? It's up to you, I guess.
It's difficult because I actually want to include Mandian in the circle.
Oh shit! Well, Mandian, unfortunately, is he is a little ways away. You can see him thanks to his glowing pebble. However, he is a fucking whopping 25 feet away.
As long as I get within, hold on, let me draw a little line. Because as long as I get within 10 feet of him, I should be able to get me and him in it.
Okay. All right.
Hold on.
Okay. It's all you, baby. I'll allow you to move and then cast it. You've earned it. You took the risk. You gambled and you won. At least so far.
Yeah. Like right there. And then,
hey, you can cast it to 120 feet away. So yeah, I don't care. I don't care if you move. You're good.
Okay.
It will be it will be concentration though, which I will remind myself of.
Damn. And yeah, it's very important that we are both inside, because the damage side is on the outside.
Okay, alright, so you want to surround yourself and Mandy and Gelden in this ring of fire. That's the play?
Yes.
Okay, yes. And this sheds light, correct? Is that true? Maybe not? I thought maybe it did. I guess it does not.
Make it up to 60 feet long, 1 foot thick, opaque, lasts the duration.
I'm really not sure. I don't think so.
Yeah, it doesn't say anything about light.
Okay. Okay, I mean, and you can't
fire,
see
but,
through
like,
it, right?
It's a magical dark.
Is that
fire,
is that also
opaque.
True?
It's opaque,
okay.
Yes.
Okay. I think there's something I can do about that maybe. See, I guess I can make a fucking another circle. I won't spend too much more time on this, but it's important. It's important. Let's see. You know what? Yeah, I kind of that. Nice.
Yeah, I like that.
You watch, man. You get on the skeezle bin bag, just moves over in front of you. And how? And what do you do to cast your wall of fire, Master Bin Bag? as soon, just every two guys are wreathed in flame.
Skeezle makes a baseball slide and both hands. Like at his hips and then rising up, and the wall just rises from the ground, burbling like a stream of magma suspended midair.
Very cool, very cool. And it isn't uncomfortably hot being on the inside of this ring of fire. You can hardly feel the heat, Manny and Gelden, as the heat will be radiated outward. Very well, Master Binbag. Anything furthermore?
Skeezwell is concentrating. And it's a strenuous task. Mm. With a powerful ward weighing on his mind. That's it.
Okay, very good. Very good. He focused upon the concentration as one of these creatures wheat tries to pass through the wall of fire, knowing that its prey is within. Let's see. This creature that ends its turn within 10 feet of that side or inside the wall. When it enters the wall for the first time. Okay. Okay, yeah. So the creature will attempt to pass through the wall. And it will take. Damn, did you cast Wall of Fire? Because you may as well, and that will roll the fire damage, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, is that true?
I believe so. And I think the creature just takes the damage. I don't think it makes a save if it enters it of its own volition. Ends its turn there, within 10 feet of that side or inside. Creature takes the same damage when it enters the wall for the first time. And that's what it says. That's what it say.
Damn, look at that damage.
Yeah, this creature tries to leap upward, passing by into the flame, even though no one can see. I guess Syphax can maybe kind of see it. This creature just leaps and jumps over yonder and just incinerated to ashes instantly. The creature gone, no more. Mandy and Geldon, you are up, surrounded in a ring of 20-foot tall opaque flame with Skeezwell bin bag.
Very good.
Really, don't touch the wall, Mandian.
Is this a safe spot to move there? Can I see that?
Oh, I'm sorry, where?
Right here?
Yeah. Okay. That's the edge right there.
Got it. Yeah, my blight doesn't go past that, so I can tell. Okay. So I can't see any of them from here, it seems. So I will. I don't know. Will I? Can't really do much. Can I, like, throw my lightning lure out there and hope I catch one and pull it through the fire?
Yeah, I'll let you try. What's the range of your lightning lure, anyway?
It's, 15-foot radius.
Interesting. Okay, so anything...
I don't know if they're 15 feet out, but...
Yeah, anything around you up to 15 feet you can try to grab. Okay, yeah. All right. I mean, yeah, you can give it a try.
Cool. There it is.
You, Samus, like, melee grapple out there with your lightning lure. Unfortunately, your lightning lure finds nothing as it is retracted back through the opaque wall of flame. The wall does seem cool. And I don't think the other side of the wall will damage you when you go through it. I'm not 100%. I'm not 100% on that. I'm not 100% on that. But the wall seems like probably you know, deceivingly non-threatening, probably from the inside.
All right. Got it. All right.
But other than that, you know, you can't see shit. you've casted your lightning lure.
I'm probably not going to do too much more.
Okay. All right. Very good. We've got Dramlings.
No.
We've got Dramlings coming for Uzgood Bonebreaker. Uzgood Bonebreaker finds himself swarmed by Dramlings all of a sudden. Beware, Uzgood Bonebreaker. You're in for a scare. 7 piercing damage. Halved. As one of these creatures bites the other, like, you know, your other side of your leg. This creature down south tries to leap up and go for the groin. It snags you on the groin for 9 piercing damage, reduced. You're kind of like punching and batting these creatures off you as they're, you know, taking small little chunks of flesh out of you. As you find yourself, you know, no weapon in hand in these dire moments. Let's see these other ones. Let's see, are they smart enough? Are they smart enough to not go in there? No. No. That one goes right for it. How about that one? Damn, that one's fucking... That one's unsure. Let's see, what else we got? Oh, we got this one. Another one, Uzgood Bonebreaker. You are just flanked on all sides. Ultimately surrounded by these small creatures trying to grapple upon you. and bite you. You take another 9 piercing damage, halved. These creatures are just intent on biting you up. Second round, top the round. Syphax, what's going on down there? And Syphax starts making his way downtown. Eager to see what's good. Let's see Syphax, let's get it, boy. Where's my man at? Dexterity check, baby. Oof. He is, he'll be making his way down slow as fuck.
Damn. Huh.
And that's that. That's that for now, unfortunately. I can't stand it. I can't stand it. Ooh, it's a good bone breaker. Here you are. Surrounded by Dramwings.
Ulzgood reaches down to try and recover his sword.
Okay. All right. It is. Unfortunately, you are beset on all sides by creatures now. So it may not be as easy as, you know, as it was a second or two ago. I would say you can do it. It'll cost you your bonus action.
It's a trap.
That's that.
I mean,
that's that if you desire to do it.
I'll go for it.
Okay. All right. Very good. So be it. So be it. It is done. You retrieve your weapon, your silver longsword in hand. At the cost of Muriel, your bonus action.
I will attack the same one in front of me.
So be it. So be it. Is looking partially wounded, that Eron Burnbath black ooze beginning to leak from the creature's open wound.
No. I got a question.
Of course.
And they already got advantage with me with these pack tactics. And what happens if I recklessly attack and give them advantage?
They might get an extra one or two points of accuracy. You know, to hitting you, as opposed to double advantage or some shit like that, right? You know, that's how I'll handle stacking advantage. You get a minor accuracy boost.
Okay. I'm just gonna deal out some longsword attacks.
Dishing out the first one. Great. Unfortunately, you cut off one of the little antenna horns of the creature in front of you. It is superficial though and doesn't seem to do any damage, unfortunately. And your other strike is just short as well. these creatures are agile, and you find yourself a little caught off guard by their curiosity. Anything furthermore, Master Bonebreaker?
I just call out for Syphax. Help me out, Syphax.
Sorry, boss, I'm on the way! you hear over yonder, these little nasty, nasty looking gremlins, try to bite you up. Trybitebiteyouup.com. 19 to strike. Ooh. Yucky. 5 piercing damage. Reduced. And let's see. This one. That was near Ski's Welpin Bad Guy. Whoops. It'll stay there and watch Syphax. That's good. I like that. Skeezle Binbag. You are in the wall of fire, where no harm has come to you and Mandy Gelden as of yet. What is it you will do?
Skeezle is going to attempt a Misty Step exit.
Oh shit. Okay. Okay. So be it.
So does that count as a level 2 spell, or is that like a special it because it's my phage?
It does count as a level 2 spell.
Alright, so I'll go for a, I'm gonna do, because it's just a bonus action when I phage teleport, so I can still perhaps do something else.
Perhaps.
Right, here I go.
Best of luck.
Oof, unfortunately, Master Binbag, you are unable to perform the casting of Misty Step at this time. Your special ability, Misty Step, is reduced, but I don't think you burn a second level spell, technically, because it's like, you know, a ability of yours.
Makes sense, so I've taken that away.
Fortunately so.
I was thinking suggestion, but you have to be able to see them.
Oh, damn, yeah, the opaqueness of the wall.
Yeah, it's fucked up.
A killer. When it comes to the fog of war, I mean, shit.
Alright. Gotta think. I think I want to... Let me look at Vicious Mockery. Maybe that... Does that go through, or do you have to see them as well? Or can you just, like, scream it?
Let me see.
No, you need vision. Alright, Sceezo Binbag. I got the one guy, right? I think I have to drop the wall. I'm dropping the wall. Does that require?
I think it's like a bonus action, maybe. But I mean, you know, I'll let you drop it at your leisure.
All right. Yeah. Sceezo's ending his concentration, basically.
Okay. Yeah. So be it. The opaque wall of fire vanishes, and two creatures are revealed before you. Well, I don't even know if you can see them. Oh yeah, you should. Well. Oh.
You have to take off my light too.
Yeah. No, I didn't. I got rid of the ring, but not the line of sight ring. Hell, well. There you go. Yeah, you guys can see Syphax beginning to make his way down, and these creatures are just sitting here waiting, looking around there, and then they look over and spot you, Sceezo Binbag. Anything furthermore?
So like, can I cast a firebolt now? Because that's what Sceezo would do if he could do.
I'll allow it.
The wall drops and Sceezo angrily rips out a firebolt at one of the dramling that's like right there in front of Syphax.
As you will. Yeah, Syphax is still a good 20 feet in the air, but that's about where he'll come down, especially if he falls. Ooh, good. A fine nice strike. Terrible. Fine strike, a mean 17 fire damage. Let's see. Oh, that's fucked. Okay, no. Yeah. All right, good. Yeah, we're good. Yeah, very good. Mean blast into that little imp beast, but it remains standing, barely, heavily singed by your fire bolt. All right, Bandy and Geldon, what do you desire to do, my friend? You can see once again, but you're also not protected, Lamau.
Bandy and Geldon swoops around, standing behind Sceezo, and fires a shot at this beast.
Oh, okay. Very good. So be it. Coming in for the follow-up. Damn. I think you're... Damn, you didn't unjam your palm pistol, did you?
Oh, shoot. I forgot.
Well, now it's double jammed. Now it's...
I sprint towards Uzgul to help him out while trying to unjam my gun.
I think it's gonna have to be an out of combat situation now, as far as that's concerned. But you can you have a spare attack if you want to use your other attack with your attack action. Your first one failing miserably.
Yeah, I guess you're right. I'll throw a Thunder Gauntlet punch.
Oh, shit.
This is now a defensive gauntlet punch.
Busting out the defensive gauntlet. Ooh, beauty. Beauty. All right, nice. Very good. Very good. And the creature is eviscerated by your punch. And then it explodes into a little bit of dram dust, affecting all within melee range, which is you. I need you to make a dexterity saving throw, as now there's just this cloud of like black dust that is flowing in your proximity. Dexterity. Where this creature once was.
Saving throw.
Oh, you make the save. You make the save, taking no necrotic damage from the Schick dust. Alright. Anything furthermore, Master Mandian? Your pompous are ruined.
5, 10, 15, 20, 25, and move up 5 more feet.
Very good.
That is it. That's my turn.
Okay. Let's see. Down to Uzgud Bonebreaker Town. The barrage continues, my friend. Prepare yourself. You've got some bites coming in. You take 8 piercing damage, halved from another munch upon your left elbow. We've got another drowning inbound, coming in with another 4 piercing damage, halved. Let's see, we've got this drowning here. Who is he going to be having you, Mandy and Gelatin? He's going to be coming in for a sweet little bite. A sweet little bite wherever he can. Ooh, a 19 to strike?
Oh. Damn. Definitely hits.
Takes 6 damage. 6 piercing damage reduced.
Reduced to 3.
And with your temporary, naturally. Probably ends up being but a scratch. Let's see, the Dramling. Down here, Master Bonebreaker, in your rear, will attempt to strike your gluteus. He will, for 9 piercing damage, halved. Thank Christ for your rage. Syphax, please. Top of the round, round 3, show us what you can do. Nah! Syphax makes his way down into the fray. Oh, sorry I'm late, guys. And he'll be joining in. Time now. Well, he'll be going last, but he's here. Uzgud Bonebreaker. These pestering creatures biting your ankles. What do you got?
I'm sheathing my longsword and pulling out the club.
Tired of beating around the bush. It'll say, take your movement this turn to switch your weaponry so elegantly and so quickly. But it is done. It is done, and your great club gifted to you by sweet Lokir, ready to swing at your leisure.
And the reckless attacks are flowing.
Unleash the reckless attack. Godspeed. Oh, hot dog. See, you strike that one down beneath you there.
That one.
Okay.
Trying to clear my sides right now.
I see. Okay, very good. Very good. So be it. First strike, taking out that side creature. It is as such, and there is a bit of dust in the wind.
I need you to make a dexterity save, Uzi Bonebreaker, with advantage. Because you just have a knack for this type of thing. To get away from inhaling this shick dust.
Oh.
You suffer, Uzi Bonebreaker. 2 necrotic damage reduced to 1 thanks to your rage. And the other strike of your great club, where's that one going? The other side? Okay, very good. So be it. 8 damage coming that creature's way. Nice little impact on that one, but it kind of rolled off the club, and you find yourself still beset. But one less beast to worry about. Anything furthermore?
It just kind of turns. And that's it.
Okay. Changing your orientation, you don't see any of these creatures' reinforcements. Seems to you, this could very well be the last of them, as the creature lunges out towards you. Giving you a nice little bite on your forearm, who is good bone breaker. 7 piercing damage. Halved. Naturally. Skis will bin bag. You're up with Mandy and Geldon on deck. What do you got, baby?
Skeezwell's belting out Akimbo style fireballs left and right. He's going for this target.
Okay. Alright, very good. So be it. Unable to make out much more, truly, it should be said. You can hear Uzu Bonebreaker fighting something off in the distance, but you're unable to make any type of visual contact. Focus on the immediate threat to you. You strike that little imp creature, dealing a nice 8 fire damage. The creature still stands. Anything else? Skeezel bin bag.
Skeezel would like to. Do I still have my Morningstar?
I would say that. Yeah, I believe so.
I'm going to take that out and walk towards Uzgud, getting to the edge of the light.
Will you make a perception check for me? Oh, are you not going to go past the darkness? Is that what you're saying?
I probably will. No, I will.
Okay.
Let me mark my move.
Sure. I was going to say, you can give me a perception check and that'll probably help, you know. See how accurately you may be able to stumble upon him. Ooh, okay. All right. I mean, you're pretty sure he's southward. Could be directly southward, it sounds to you.
All right. Skeezwill is going to go directly south. He heads in the direction of Wolfsgood.
Hearing the grunts and groans of your companion and the chattering of these small creatures that seems somewhat familiar to you. You make your way down, kind of feeling your way, stumbling in the dark, unsure of what you may find. Best of luck, Master Binbag.
Oh, there he goes.
Manny and Geldon, you probably not watching too close attention, but you know, if you dare look, Skeezel Binbag is removed from your person.
No, I mean it's fine.
Skeezel Binbag, you stumble upon Uzgud Bonebreaker and company, and also one of these small pygmy creatures. And I think that's where we'll leave you. Mandy and Geldon, you are up, my friend, with a beast before you.
Oh, well. He'll just have to get gauntlet punched a couple times. Thunder gauntlet punch.
Ooh, your first defensive gauntlet shy of the creature.
Thunder gauntlet punch.
Ooh, your next strike landing quite squarely upon the beast, dealing 8 thunder damage. Excellent. Excellent. Anything furthermore? Creature still stands. Though quite wounded, it should be said.
No.
Okay. All right. Oh, sweet Usgood Bonebreaker. I've got more bots coming your way, boy. Ooh, a 17 to hit you?
Mm-hmm.
Shit, that's a sham. That's a sham. You take 8 piercing damage, halved. As that glancing blow turns into a bit more of a grievous one. Mandian, this creature before you that you struck at is going to try to chomp you. An 18?
That does in fact hit.
That does in fact chomp you?
It
does. Hold on. Hold on a fucking minute. Hold on now. Come on, girl. What you got for me? Shit. Come on, dude. Let's see, Syphax. When a creature you can see attacks a target other than you and within 5 feet of you, you can use a reaction to impose disadvantage on the attack. You must be wielding a shield. Syphax said, no! And he tries to shield bash this little drambling Mandy and Geldon before it munches onto your groin, using his reaction to cause disadvantage. I could drop the roll again. Oh shit! Well, Syphax is like, no, don't! And he goes with like his offhand and like tries to like clobber this little creature, and ends up like, you know, like sweeping it in the back of the head, and the creature's teeth just like, you know, just gets like pushed into you ever further, with like the force of Syphax's shield bash working in the creature's favor. unfortunately, you still suffer the 8 piercing damage reduced. That's a shame. But hey,
what a shame.
Syphax thought of it. Nice work, Syphax.
It was a good try.
Let's see. Skeezel Binbag. Face to face with one of these little alien pygmies. The Dramling will attempt to bite your robed, squishy person. A 12 to hit you? That ain't nothing, I'm pretty sure. Pretty close. Pretty close. Just tears a little bit of your
wily one.
Tears a little bit of your travel cloak, but other than that, you are looking good. Huh. You can say that again, Skeezwell. And Syphax, with his shield in one hand and short sword in the other, will attempt to stab this little creature. He tries to go for a stab. The creature narrowly ducks it. It's like, just die already! And Syphax goes for a chop. Chopping the top of the creature's head off just so. That's right! For the Crimson Bones! And then the creature explodes. And I need Syphax and Mandy Gelden to make dexterity saving throws.
Shit.
You guys are both caught in the shit cloud. Oh shit, Mandy Gelden, you are looking good. Syphax is not. Syphax takes 2 necrotic damage. Other than that, slaying a Dramling. I hear you, comrades! I'm on my way! And Syphax makes his way downtown. Let's see, let's get a perception check from him. With disadvantage, because he's coughing now. Damn, still really good. He's just, and makes his way right here to the boys. Let's go, hey, what's going on? But unable to do much else, he will not do much else. Too exacerbated to even bust out a bardic inspiration. But Syphax has joined the fray. Who's a Bonebreaker? You're up, baby.
More reckless attacks.
Hey.
Reckless.
I don't blame you. Ooh. First one eliminates that the creature you're facing frontmost. I need dexterity save from you, Uzgu Bonebreaker, with advantage. And Syphax will do the same thing as well. Naturally. Ooh, Syphax makes it. Uzgu does not. Oh well. Damn, you take one necrotic damage, Uzgu Bonebreaker. Not halved.
Darn it.
Other than that, though, let's see. Your other swing lands as well. Which other creature did you desire to strike? The already wounded one. Most keenly, Uzgu Bonebreaker. You strike this creature down as well. How does it die? Flourish of swings.
Squished, and the black goop goes splatting on the floor.
Yeah! You know, squirts out like a black rotten fruit, just spraying everywhere. And it remains there for a second or two as you whiff the club up before it and the dram oil evaporates into this phantom assassin teleport-esque effect. Spraying dram dust everywhere. Let's get some more dexterity saves. Unfortunately, Uzgu Bonebreaker, you succumb. You succumb to more of this chic dust. But it hardly phases you. Another one measly damage. The best these creatures can do is to injure you as they die. Anything else?
No.
Okay. Alright, very good. Very good. Decent amount of kills under your belt this combat. Skis will binbag with Mandy and Gelden up next. What is it you desire to do? Sir Skiswell.
Skiswell is gonna see the dust. And he's gonna say that he doesn't want the dust. He's gonna back up, taking the disengage action.
Oh, okay. Very good. Very good. Sacrificing your action to get away from this creature safely. Where will you go? What will you do next?
All right. So I can't see that creature now, but I still want a firebolt.
Unfortunately,
you might quicken.
Yes. I'm pretty sure. Yeah, sure. Sure. But I'm pretty sure.
Reference, but
I mean, you are.
I can spend some sorcery to. But either way, hold on.
Yeah. I mean, you're the expert. You're the expert, to be fair. Yeah. Well, sorcery action, dude. This could very well be what the what that meta magic's intended for. So yeah. I mean, you could very well be correct. Very good. Very good. Yeah, you may deduct two sorcery points to cast Firebolt freely, and I'll allow you to hit this creature without a penalty, because you're pretty sure where it is, a mere 10 feet away from you. And you have keen, shrewd eyes. Unfortunately, you watch as the Firebolt just lands to the side of the creature. No effect.
What a shame.
Fair play. Fair play. All right. Skiswell. That was Skiswell's move.
Definitely deployed, and all happened but in a flash. But alas, it was not quite enough. Mandy and Gelden, your comrades have left your immediate visual range.
Yeah, I'm used to it. I will. So I think I saw them turn south, like in actuality. So I'll go south with them. I will advance 10 feet at a time.
Okay, very good. Yeah, you don't come across much in your first 10 feet, and then you bump into Syphax.
Oh god! Syphax.
And then you see that. And then you see next to Syphax is this other little alien creature. And he also screams along with Syphax as you kind of bump into them both. He's like,
oh shit! And I reflexively throw a Thunder Gauntlet punch.
Very good. Oh, very good. Your first strike landing quite deftly for 5 thunder damage upon the creature.
Excellent. It has disadvantage against targets other than me. I throw another Thunder Gauntlet punch.
Oh, very good. Oh. Very good. Oh, oh. Excellently landed. Excellently landed. Excellently landed. Very nice. Very nice. The creature still stands, but barely. After the creature isn't screaming anymore. It seems quite heavily dozed. Anything furthermore, Mandy and Gildan?
Nah, I'm gonna defend Syphax.
Okay. Very good. Very good. I'm sure. I'm sure he will appreciate it. As the creature kind of like shakes off the effect, you watch as it like crumples into this little black like ball of pudding that spills this oil on the ground and then like slithers down into this nearby grate, depriving everyone of the final kill and also escaping deeper into the sewer works.
What a disgusting freak.
And that is where we'll take our break for now.
I hate the sewer. Whoa, map's so zoomed in.
Yeah.
Nice.
All right, gentlemen. Yeah, very good. Very good. Our combat concluding.
Well done, lads.
Well done, lads.
Another one survived. No problem.
Another one survived. All right, it was good. It's good teamwork. Everyone got down there in time.
Good shit.
Cecil Bingbag did good stemming the crowd before a scene was caused. It could have been a totally different encounter. That's for sure.
Very true.
You got it.
All right, Crimson Bones. Here we find the four of you, sweet lads, down within the depths of Garza in the sewer works. It's slimy, it's filthy. You seem to be alone as the purple amulet around Mandian's neck begins to dim and subside back to how it once was, and you're left with the dripping, damp stone of the Garza sewer system.
So damp. We have a giant grate in front of me, right?
There is the one that the creature slid into. There's the there's like the door, you know, and then there's another grate on the opposite end of the room as well that kind of mirrors this one that this creature just slurmed into. Pretty sizable. Seems pretty sturdy.
What's up with the door? I can't see the door though.
Not currently. Okay. It's still very dark down here. Very difficult to see anything down here unless you're Uzgood Bonebreaker.
Uzgood Skeezwell. How are we out of this mess?
I'm blind as a bat.
I'll light a torch and hand it to Mandian.
Oh. Okay. Alright, you can exact a torch. As Manny Gelden, you are given one, just like that.
Oh, thank you. Very good. I would like to approach said door that I can now see.
Damn, okay, very good. You can do so much more confidently. It's a large door, probably about 6 feet tall or so. seems like perhaps it may open from this side, though you're not exactly sure where the activation mechanism may be. And it seems, you know, seems awfully sturdy to you.
I would like to look for some sort of latch or lock or lever.
All right, very good. You may investigate. You may investigate.
I investigate.
Ooh. Ooh.
A true 9.
You have a rough time figuring this out. It seems like this door was perhaps placed here as more of a barrier than perhaps something that, you know, is to be frequently open and close. And you're left after a few seconds scratching your head. We'll get this pretty nasty imposing door.
Only vertical bars? Or are there also horizontal bars?
There are three very thick vertical bars and then one pretty thick horizontal bar about in the middle of the doorway.
I would like to grab hold of the horizontal bar and try to lift it upwards and see if that works.
Ooh, okay. Very good. Very good. Give me a strength check, Mandy and Gelden.
Strength check.
You think it budges a little bit upward.
Oh, shit. It was cool. Excuse me. Help me out with this. You guys are strong.
Saw that bulging.
I'll do it.
Let's go, man.
Get out of the way and let them take care of the door.
Damn. Okay. Very good. Very good. You got the... You have the muscle move in. So I was like, what? Don't look at me.
Come on,
don't look at me,
man.
Strong guys. Okay, well, all right, I guess.
Let's play some music.
No. Diddly da, diddly do, diddly dee. And Syphax plays a little jaunty tune. Sea's open bag was good. You guys have a pretty gnarly steel door ahead of you. It's up to you if you guys want to roll strength independently or one of you with advantage.
What do you think, Skeezwell?
Mine is 3.
Mine's 6.
Oh.
So you should roll with advantage, surely.
Okay. Well, just like that. Just like that. A 13. A 13?
Same.
Yeah, it's enough to get it budging. But it is immense. It is immensely heavy and very dense, this metallic gate-ass door. It is not enough to get the charge done, and you boys need to wait a minute or two to try again. Okay. In that time, Mandy and Gelden, you have a few seconds to, you know, to kind of reflect, and you recognize those creatures as the same ones that you encountered in the fog forest. They appeared like shadow cats to you then, but it seems now that these creatures' true forms have been unveiled. And these shadow cat beasts were indeed dramlings.
I can't believe it. I can't believe it. All right, well, that explains the glowing. Is my amulet still glowing?
No, no longer.
Okay, good, good, good.
I would say so. I would say so. Is there any brief chatter being had?
Excuse well, I would imagine you had some sort of levitation abilities with all these fireballs and walls. Then you have a little more utility other than killing.
Skizlo checks his component pouch. Yes.
Cool. Come on, you must have some feathers in there or something. It's destruction magic.
Yeah, I don't have much. I could put... that would never work, though. It's no way to make the ice jam it up. Like, slowly, like, destroy it with careful water placement.
Jam it up.
Try and use the mage hand as like a block and tackle, but it can only hold 10 pounds, so that doesn't actually change the amount of lifting we can get.
True. You can get 10 pounds extra lifting.
Well, like, because if we're pulling down on the mage hand with like our body weight in force, it's always going to be more than 10. It's not that hardy. Unless there's like something in the ceiling we can attach rope to attempt to pulley the
Mandy, it looks straight
bar up.
Well, with your torch that Wuzgoo Bonebreaker provided you, Mandy and Gelden, probably able to just barely make out the ceiling, but it does. It's very flat.
Damn. Okay.
Very flat and featureless, unfortunately.
I don't know. I think you guys are just gonna have to give it your all. How many of us can we fit on that door? And Manny will kind of get up against the door with them and see if he can squeeze in and help with them.
All right, you can do what you can, but it seems like it's mainly gonna be up to Skeezel, Vinbag, and Wuzgoo Bonebreaker. The bars sick, it's difficult to get a grip on anything stable.
Shoot, okay.
And with that being said, strength team, it's your time to shine once again, baby. Oof.
Damn.
It's rough. It's rough. This is a dense, very, very heavy door. Very heavy. It's heavier than Mandy and Gelton.
If I were to rage, would that impose any kind of additional advantage?
You'd probably be able to get it if you raged. If you were willing to sacrifice one of your valuable rages to get that primal strength going, you could probably get it done.
Well, I'm thinking after three failures, Ulzgood probably will hit a rage, so I think we're gonna give it one more try.
Okay.
More of a choice, right. Just will be enraged.
Yeah.
Another minute or two passes. And eventually you're feeling like you're up to the task. Try it again.
Oh, Ulzgood's getting mad. Oh,
Skeezel says mad. Maybe you should eat your charcuterie snack. Get your strength up.
Well, it's good to enter the rage.
Okay. All right. Very good. Very good. You watch as the blood, the veins begin to pop in the pale flesh of your half orc comrade as the muscles tense and Wuzgoo Bonebreaker gives it all he's got to try to rip this steel gate open. Please, Master Bonebreaker, tear it up. Tear it up if you dare, Mon Frere.
Please.
With that, it's just enough. You watch as like it gets to the same point that it has before, and it seems like it's gonna slide down, and that's when Wuzgoo Bonebreaker, in a flash, squats downward and grips the very bottom of the door that's ever so barely like an inch or so off the ground, and full-on lifts it up to the entire extent of his person, and he is now standing erect, wielding the entire weight of this door himself.
Go.
Minion Calvin just scrambles underneath.
Okay. Very good. Everyone scrambles underneath, including Syphax. And now it is you who is the bone breaker with the impossible weight of this door. And your rage. Will you squirm to the other side of it?
I will sure attempt to.
Okay. All right. Very good. Very good. I would say with your excellent rage, you are just able to do so. Syphax assisting before we have to push him out of the way as you let the thing slam behind you. And you gentlemen are now confined in this area. Deep into the sewer works. Seems like you're in this 10-foot wide by 8-foot tall hallway, seemingly. And you are left with but the cold, sweet, dripping sounds of the Garza sewer works.
Well, I guess we don't have any other choice but to go forward. Manny Geldman will start leading the way with the torch.
Okay, so good.
I'm gonna eat that snack that Skeezball was talking about.
Okay, very good, very good. How is the snack, Skeezball been bagged? Please remind us of your chicanery snack.
Yeah, I mean, they were a critical failure, but, like, it's got good ingredients.
It can only be so bad. Just looks a little crude, I suppose.
Well, this guy didn't even notice.
Scrumptious. Mandy Geldon, you with the torch now are pushing up to what seems to be a change in the makeup of this room. The tunnel is now opening, and it seems like it is reaching into another hallway that is moving in a different direction. It seems like you're at what appears to be a T junction here.
I sense a T junction here. It just goes off in either way, right? I can't tell if one ends.
Now without getting closer, of course, and entering within the T junction.
I will enter within the T junction, going what's left and right.
I'll go left and right.
Start heading towards the right.
Okay, heading right, which would be southward, as it is. You step out from this hallway into a bit of a larger area, as you enter into the T junction zone and start heading right. Seems like it's about 15 feet wide and about 10 feet tall, but, you know, pretty spacious for an underground sewer works. And there is two landings with a pretty foul-looking stream of what could very well be like waist-high water moving in between them, flowing from left to right in the direction you're heading. You are following the flow of this sewage canal.
Okay. I guess it's best to follow the canal. I look back towards my companions.
Follow the flow, Mandian. It'll get us to an exit.
It's gotta be right. Sound logic.
No one knocks this shit by the heat.
And I continue with the flow of sewage.
Okay, very good. Very good. You continue pushing along. And at this point, Manny Geldon, I guess I'll have you make a perception check. Because you hear, a chance of hearing something up ahead. And it seems like you are entering into another junction area. It seems like this could be a four-way sewer intersection. where the canal splits.
Terrible. All right.
13 perception over the gentle sound of flowing sewage and the dripping of the atmosphere. You hear what seems like a croaking. Up to your right, what will be westward in this four-way intersection.
Is that with or against the stream?
That'd be against the stream. This is all one right. of the this particular. Okay. All as a matter of fact, all the streams are flowing into the middle here and then weeding westward.
Okay. And is that croaking across the stream somehow, or is it on my side?
Hard to say. It could very well be on your side. Seems like it's around the corner, to the right, which will be eastward in this case.
Okay.
And you right now you're heading south, about to head into this four-way sewer intersection.
I would like to investigate the croaking.
Ooh. Okay. All right. Very good. Very good. Are you just turning your head around the corner?
Yes. For now.
Okay. All right. So be it.
Poke the torch out of my head.
So be it. Let's see. What will you be able to discover? You don't find much. Immediately turning the corner, you are met with the absence of much of anything.
Okay.
Oops.
All right.
And then you hear it again. A croaking. A croaking coming from up ahead, somewhere in the darkness, just out of the range of what your torch can illuminate.
I will turn the corner and continue that way.
Okay. You continue in pursuit of this strange noise, unsure of what it could be.
Oh, I have an idea.
You push ever further. Whoopsie.
Whoa.
I'm just fucking it all up. Okay, so what is our marching order? I suppose we ought to clear that up before I continue any further. We've got Manny Gildan up front leading with the torch. I assume Uzgood Bonebreaker in a close second place.
Yeah.
Okay. And I imagine either Skeezwell or Syphax after that, of course.
I would prefer to be in the back.
Okay, the rearmost position, so be it, Master Binbag. You gentlemen keep pushing in this SWAT-style arrangement, drawing ever nearer. And from just around the corner, it seems like perhaps this small little 5-foot ledging opens up to a bit of a larger alcove up here on the right, as from out of the darkness, as you are pushing forward, steps out before you this 3.5 foot tall, like, spear holding, yellow eyed, green skinned, seems like amphibian man who just kind of stands there looking at you all. Kind of checking you all out with his weird little frog like eyes, and then he jumps into the sewer water.
Manion yells halt and points his gun in his general direction. Not sure if you'll understand me.
It is over in a matter of seconds.
Uzgubonebreaker's excited.
Uzgubonebreaker probably just barely able to see, you know, the edge of the, you know, of this creature as it leaps away, and poops right into the murky sewer water, and it's not seen again. The water's stilling out, and the croaking subsiding.
It's the frogman, I knew it. Manion says.
Frogs. I like frogs.
Well.
I don't like small people things.
I actually have to find more about them, so. Keep your eyes out.
Can I inspect the water for any animals? Perhaps smaller frogs?
Ooh, sure. I'll let you do an investigation check or perception. It's up to you. You lean in real close and look around deeply. The water's atrocious. It's terribly hard to see through. Even for your keen eyes that are adapted to this level of low light, you are unable to really pierce through the film of this murky, you know, waste-filled liquid. It is quite disturbing. You'd think perhaps you catch the glimpse of something here and there, but it, you know, quickly passes from view, and you're unable to follow anything for more than a handful of moments. You're unsure what dwells in there. The imagination stirs, though, after what you caught a glimpse of just now.
Well, Lusgood would like to just keep his eyes out for any tiny frogs on their adventure.
Okay. Duly noted. All right. Well, what's the play now, gentlemen? We're going to continue the way that we're heading.
I suppose so, right? Well, I think we want to turn around and head back down following the flow of the stream, right? We're going counter the stream right now. Correct?
That is true.
Mandy.
Yes. Yes. Turn back the way we came. We're going to follow the stream.
Okay. All right, very good. The file shuffles along. But at this point, there's a large step where you guys have to, you know, do a bit of a hop over this this narrow gap that contains the sewer water to get on the other side of the lane, so you can continue following it with ease, which is easily done. It's only a 5 foot gap. Which is quite easily cleared by all. But you gentlemen continue pushing down into the darkness of the Garza sewer system. And we'll do so, spoiler alert, for quite a little while.
Oh, shit. Okay.
Feels like probably at least a half an hour passes or so as you gentlemen are pushing along what seems to be an endless tunnel way, and then all of a sudden, Mandy and Gelden, your torch light illuminates the ceiling as it banks down at a 45 degree angle, and sure enough, this way descends and heads but deeper into the sewer, as you likely suspected.
Well, I will have to put up with it and continue deeper.
Okay. All right. I'll have a constitution. The torch is beginning to fade, but it probably still has at least another good 45 minutes of life in it.
All right.
These adventuring brand torches are phenomenal. at retaining a decent light for at least a good hour or two. Oh, that being said, the odor down here in this place is another matter entirely. Let's get some constitution checks, everyone, just to make sure everyone's handling the sewage system with a strong stomach.
What are we looking for? Which roll?
Constitution check, please, everyone.
Constitution check.
We're gonna see how well everyone can keep, you know, take this environment. As I suspected, maybe, Gelden, you're not one for traipsing around in the sewer ways. It is foul down here. Far worse than being in the tomb of Gilgamesh. This isn't like, you know, your standard stale air. This is ripe, just foul,
great,
fume-ridden, yucky, just yucky.
That's what I came here for.
You'll definitely feel like you'll need a good bathing after this, most certainly.
I close my visor, seal it real shut.
You do your best to repel the scent and eventually the taste of the sewer atmosphere. God. Well, yeah, so it's bad. It's bad. But you do your best to push past it and continue on. Heading down now, the Crimson Bones, for another good 10 minutes or so. Uzgu Bonebreaker, you stumble upon a small frog. You can see the glint. Okay. All right. You see the glint of its slimy skin across the sewer way, resting on the other ledge, just near the river way. It'll be one leap away from being within the sewer water, so you'll have to be quick. Give me a dexterity check, Uzgu Bonebreaker. The Latin plane.
Dexterity.
Ooh, alas. You make a dive and reach for the creature just as it jumps, and the small green frog drops into the disturbing sewer water, rushing downward into the deep.
Oh, close.
Perhaps next time, my friend. Ska, who's good frog catcher, Syphax says.
Hopefully we can get some. Keep your eyes out, Syphax.
A fan of amphibians, huh?
What?
You know, frogs?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. Huh. Nice. I guess frogs are pretty good. Frogs. Syphax looks down at his little cricket pet and kind of conceals it beyond his travel cloak. Don't worry, you'll be safe. Syphax carries on with the Crimson Bones. You guys really have nothing but the sounds of this sewer water, the occasional dripping noise. and then the occasional croak that reaches out to you from the darkness, though you're not too sure what it may mean. Let's see. And for seemingly, perhaps, another half hour or so, the Crimson Bones, you gentlemen continue traveling downward at a steady 45-degree angle. Eventually, it banks and turns 90 degrees and continues downward, seemingly deeper and deeper into the darkness. It is some serious foul conditions. Manny and Gelton, I'll need another constitution check from you, baby. As your torchlight grows dimmer, the conditions here have seldom improved, but you've managed to steel yourself and have and are not will not succumb to the foul odoriferousness of the sewer of the sewer area just yet.
I'm getting used to it.
It seems so. It seems so. See, and in this time, gentlemen, you spot a rat. You spot a rat or two. Most definitely. Most definitely.
I'll try and catch one of them.
Oh. Okay. Very good. Very good. Loose Bonebreaker, give me another dexterity check to attempt to catch these vermin barehanded. Oh, you're able to get your hands on a rat. Pretty sizable brown rat. You've got him. Sci-fi's like, whoa!
And, let's see.
The rat squirms and cries.
As far as doing one of my rituals, do I have to, like, stand still? Or can I do some, like, mobile chanting?
Ooh. Ooh, rituals on the move? Yeah, I don't think it's gonna happen. I don't think it's gonna happen. You kind of need, like, a place to forge your little, like, sea bear circle and do, you know, perform the ritual. Yeah, man, it will require, I guess, 10 minutes of stationary preparation.
You know, but you have a rat. It's just a rat, though.
It's like squirming around. It's a little rat tail flopping. Pretty sizable rat, too.
How big is the rat?
It's probably, oh geez. It's pretty fat. It's a pretty fat rat. I would say, you know, I would say, yeah, but definitely on the bigger end of how big rats get, but not abnormally large. You can hold it with one hand with ease. But it has a good amount of weight to it.
Ulsgood looks to the Crimson Bones. You guys cool with taking a 10-minute breather?
Ugh. Yeah, I can get my wits about me.
Hi, Beth.
Ezo grabs the rat with the mage hand to keep it separate from Ulsgood, allowing him to prepare for his ritual.
Thanks.
Damn.
Nice.
the rat helpless.
And okay. I'll hand another torch off over to Mandy and Gelden before I start my ritual.
Damn. Okay. Very good. Very good. As the torchlight's just starting to fade. To perhaps its utmost degree before snuffing out. You activate another torch, pass it over to Mandy and Gelden, and the torch timer begins yet again.
Excellent.
In these 10 minutes, time passing, Syphax complains about how hard it is to relax, not only in the sewer, but because you are at a 45-degree incline, so it is, you know, it's not typically the most comfortable of areas. And that landing you left behind you is long gone. However, in these 10 minutes, is anyone chatting about anything? Mandy and Skeezwell or Syphax, as Ulsgood Bonebreaker prepares prepares his ritual.
Can I work on my module?
Yes. Yeah, sure. Sure.
Nice.
it's only going to be, you know, a few minutes of work, but...
Hey, you know, if I can get 1% on it, that's fine.
All right. Okay. All right. Very good. Very good. Give me an intelligence check.
Ah, shit.
Well, we'll see. Well, we'll see about that. We'll see about that.
All right. All right.
Syphax kind of, you know, checking you out. Checking out all the Crimson Bones. What does your ritual look like? Who is the Bonebreaker? What ritual are you going for, pray tell?
I'm going with the speak with animals.
Okay. All right. And what do you imagine Uzg the Bonebreaker would do to prepare to speak with this rat?
He's getting into the mind of the rodent. He's trying to be the rodent, and he is squeaking and getting into deeper squeaks because I felt like he was kind of doing a mouse at first.
Very good, very good. Taking a little bit to refine the process. It's a few attempts before you hit the exact right vocalization, the exact rat vocalization correct. And you are able, you think now confidently, to speak with this rat creature, and will be able to do so for the next 10 minutes.
First I'll ask him what his name is, if he has one.
Let me down, damn it! How do you speak? How do you understand me? How do I understand you?
I'll tell Skeezball to hover him over to me and drop him.
Skeezball complies.
Okay, very good, very good. I'm gonna look up the stat block of a rat, so I can understand what we're dealing with here. Yeah, I mean they got 2 intelligence. They got 10 wisdom though.
What?
And 4 charisma. Interesting. Okay.
What's going on?
All right. Gotta take that into account. And the small brown rats are wheezing. Ah, finally, my chance to leave. My chance to get out of here. And the rat starts scampering along the wall. he's gonna attempt to bolt.
I couldn't grab him.
You can if you desire. you can stop him if you want to. That's up to you.
I'm gonna grab him.
Okay, alright. You grab him. He kinda like comes over your way. He's like, oh, no! Don't eat me! Don't eat me!
Not eating you.
What do you want?
You tell me. What's up with the frogs down here?
Well, it's wet. It's wet. Where's this wet? There's frogs. There's frogs. There's food.
What's up with the big ones? Are they bad?
Bad news. Nothing good about frogs, I tell you that. Especially the frog men. Frog men are bad.
I'll give them a slap. I like frogs.
Yeah, blah, blah. Yeah. Let me go.
Nah, you're gonna tell me, are there a lot of these frogs down here?
Plenty of them. Tons and
what's
tons.
What's down this slope?
Yeah, more frogs. More frogmen, the Frog King!
Frog King?
Yeah.
Well.
That's right.
I said I wasn't gonna eat you. Tell the other rats to leave us alone.
Yes.
And
yes.
I'll let them go.
he quickly scampers and scatters across the ground and heads deeper in the direction you gentlemen were gonna go. And the sounds of him fade, the sounds of his huffing and puffing, fade in the distance along with the scampering. And the rest of the Crimson Bones you watch as Usk Bonebreaker seemingly has some type of, you know, squeak off with this small creature before eventually releasing it.
I warned the Crimson Bones. He spoke of a Frog King.
Frog King?
That's Frog all that King
was about.
Oh man.
Yeah, they're not friendly. King of the Exit.
Not friendly Frog King, huh? Well, I don't know. We don't want to cause a diplomatic incident, right, guys?
No. Saying not friendly to rats, at least. What trouble do they want with us?
Who knows?
You're the one that said you wanted to look at about the frogs, right, Mannion? What is it you want with them?
I don't know, we just have to, I don't know, take a look at them, I guess.
Oh.
Maybe he tries to remember about what Shekel was saying about it.
All right, yeah, you can do a history check. You recall Shekel just saying in passing that they were giving him a hard time. I'm not sure if you were thinking perhaps, you know, this could be like a favor you could do for him to get in his good graces or something to that effect. But you don't reckon he said anything expressly about being able to reward you.
Well, that's fine.
But you know, he did mention frog people in the sewer giving him a hard time. So far that all fits the bill. But he didn't speak in any particulars, unfortunately.
All right, well.
That's pretty fine. Sus, boys.
We'll just have to keep an eye out for those frogs then. That's all.
Yeah. All right. With that, Crimson Bones. Mannion, you make little to no progress on your module, by the way. Oh well.
Fuck.
In the dark sewer, in the dank dark sewer area.
Fine.
You find it difficult to concentrate. And eventually, about a half hour later, in which Usk Bonebreaker, you spot another small frog.
I'll try and take that too.
Dexterity time, baby.
Collect it all.
Show us what you got. Damn. Unfortunately, like as you weep, the small waterway, the creature hops into the water as you do so. But you are, I would say part of you is definitely pleased to see this, a decent, seems to you, frog population in the area.
Yeah.
And over the course of the next half hour, as Usk Bonebreaker attempts to catch a frog and narrowly fails, you gentlemen now, your landing tapers off and becomes flat once again. And now it seems like the area beyond this little waterway is going to expand a good deal wider. And this could very well open up into some other type of expansive interior.
Shit, okay.
Also take note, Manny Gelden, as just before you, just as you're heading down to the very end of this decline that you gentlemen have been traveling on now for what feels like hours at this point, you see the blue shimmer of like a, you know, of like a film, you know, like a blue filmic, like magical shimmering before you. Seems to have like a blue hue to it.
Okay. In this room, or like it's juxtapositioned?
Ooh, it's just within this other room. Probably about a good like 10 or 15 feet ahead of you.
All right. And it's just like illuminating empty space.
Kind of, sort of. It doesn't cast any light itself, but but it reflects kind of like a bluish hue from the light of your torch.
Okay. I'll approach it.
Okay. Very good. As you dare. Give me an intelligence check, Manny and Gildan.
Roger.
As you draw ever nearer, this space widening up a decent amount. Ooh, this seems like it. You're not sure if it's right, but this could very well be the bottom end of the Dram Ward. You could very well be so deep beneath the city at this time that you are reaching the 1 mile radius of the Dram Ward. In a subterranean environment.
You're saying we might be underneath it?
You might be underneath it. This could be you passing underneath it right now.
Okay, alright. Okay.
Or at least perhaps, you know, passing underneath, you know, the bottom quadrant of it.
Right.
To
right.
get out, you know. In some degree, you seem to be leaving it. Unless this is something else and you are terribly misjudging it. It looks remarkably similar to the Dram Ward, you know, when you pass through it. What would be probably 3 days ago now when you first entered the city.
All right. Pretty cool.
You are nice. Deep. If your theory is correct, you are deep underneath the city at this time.
So this seems like a pretty sizable room.
So far, it's kind of widened up, and it seems like it's both vertically and horizontally larger in dimensions.
All right, I'd like to do a perimeter walk.
Ooh, okay, the classic Manny Gillen perimeter walk. Any preference on which side you hug?
I want the wall to be on my right.
Okay, very good. You hug the right hand side. See, that kind of opens up about 10 feet or so, and then eventually you hit more flat wall, and this large rectangular room carries on for another good, you know, 40 feet or so before you hit a hard corner, and you have to bank and continue. Following the perimeter wall, eventually making it to another pretty gnarly looking door, it seems to you.
Okay. Did I go all the way around?
No, you may continue if you desire. This seems like the halfway point.
I will call Syphax over to stand by this door.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Come stand by this door.
Well, probably my easiest job yet. Consider it done. Syphax remains by the door.
You just yell out if you hear anything. And Manuel will continue this perimeter walk.
Okay. All right. Very good. You make it around to the point where you pretty much started. It seems that this room is symmetrical. It doesn't seem to be a bit, you know, of a like elongated rectangle to some degree. There's only the single channel, which kind of has widened a little bit and runs through this room in the direction from, you know, whence you came. Heading down past you and kind of going underneath the doorway. That Syphax is standing by and leading seemingly deeper into the sewer works of Garza.
Oh, I suppose we have no choice but to get through this door and deeper up and in. How do we feel about that?
Let's do it.
I'm ready.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Alright, so be it. You gentlemen return to Syphax, find him patiently waiting by this iron gate.
Thanks, Syphax.
Hey guys, hey,
you didn't get it open for me?
No, I heard some croaking. I heard some ribbiting.
Well,
from where?
From beyond there. And he kind of points over, you know, past the iron gate, into the darkness of another, you know, generic looking sewer hallway beyond.
Maybe it's the king himself, Mannion says.
Don't speak like that. Mannion G's.
Come on, Syphax, get this door open.
I'll do what I can. Syphax checks it out. Seems like the lock's pretty rusted to me. Stand back. And Syphax goes for a kick on this bad girl. And the door swings open. The iron gate busts underneath his strength. There you go. It is as such.
Huh. Not too bad, huh?
Pretty good side effects. You have your uses.
That's right. For the Crimson Bones.
Crimson Bones.
Alright. What are we doing for marching order here, gentlemen? Who's taking the lead?
Manny will take the lead again with the torch.
Same marching order as last time? Is that what I'm to understand?
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Nice. Very good, gentlemen. Very good, gentlemen. It is as such. And you all delve deeper into the sewer works up ahead in anticipation of an encounter with the mysterious frog folk of the deep underground. And that is where we will leave you gentlemen for now. And we will pick up next week.
Very good. Mile underground.
A mile underground. Fresh from the confines of the Dram Ward, but not in the way I'm sure anyone was quite hoping for. And unsure of what you may find necessarily next. Likely some frog men. We'll see, boys. We'll see.
Very good.
Well done, lads. Well done, lads. An interesting one indeed.